opportunity to be here. I have been working with DEPA, and I came here 6 months ago and gave a presentation on the kind of work that we're doing in terms of ethics and water. DEPA listened to the presentation, and now we've started working together. And her background is on water governance, and my background is environmental philosophy and ethics. So I'm going to just flip through. So the area that I'm looking at now is the Philippi horticultural area, and I've drawn a really detailed map. This is the Cape Peninsula, and this is Stellenbosch University, where I come from. And the Cape Flats is here. This is the Cape Peninsula. This is False Bay. So the Philippi horticultural area is here, and it's located close to an aquifer. And it's also surrounded by informal settlements. The Khayelitsha settlement, when you land in Cape Town, you pass over it. And the Cape Flats area was an area of forced removal. So it's surrounded by low-income area with lots of unemployment. And it's also, as I say, got an aquifer underneath it. So it's got a lot of social ecological issues, which make it a great case study for ethical analysis. So that's just a map from the city of Cape Town showing the extent of the area. It's subdivided into small farmer ownership, so it's owned by small farmers, and it's also some of it is owned, as I understand, it's got development rights have been passed on it. And this is the big contention. The city of Cape Town wants to develop the area, and the agroecology farmers there don't want it to be developed. And that's the kind of ethical dispute that we're going to be focusing on. So why water justice in South Africa now? It's because we're in drought and flood. The whole El Nino thing has hit South Africa, so we're the Western Cape, Stellenbosch, currently is down to its lowest levels ever. Our dam levels, and in other parts there's flooding. So water is majorly on the agenda now, the development agenda in South Africa. And who has the right to what water where is a big issue. So water justice is right in the forefront. And our constitution enshrines the right to water for everyone, but the question we're asking from a governance perspective is how does that translate on the ground? And integrated water resource management is the paradigm. And it was adopted hook, line, and sinker in South Africa. So we've adopted it into our national policy. And on paper, it looks great because it's got the three major issues: efficiency, equity, and sustainability. Those are the three concepts. But once again, the issue that we've come up with is how do you prioritize these in a particular place? What does it mean? Whose right to water should be protected in the Philippi horticultural area? Is it the city of Cape Town and the greater population of Cape Town? Or is it the horticultural farmers there who have a historical attachment to the place? Whose right should be protected? And how do you deal with a case study where there's contested rights and all seem to have different weightings, but equally emotionally attached to the issues. So why ethics? Why philosophy? Why does the water the Stellenbosch University Water Institute want the ethics department in philosophy, the unit for environmental ethics, to become involved? Why can't they just do it themselves? Why do they need us? And I think to give you an example. Willem de Klerk, who we also work with in the Water Institute, he said, more science is not going to help us. We have solutions to implement, for instance, in the Red River catchment. They have solutions that could better allocate water, but there's a lack of trust between the farmers and the government, and the emerging farmers and other farmers and the government. So even if you have the perfect technical solution, you cannot get people to adopt it, because there's this breakdown of trust, this sense of we're not talking about the same development plan here, and yeah, so that's where ethics comes in. That's where, when you've got these deep-seated value differences between parties, that's when ethics is necessary. It's not necessary, I mean, there's different levels of ethics. You get professional ethics, you get business ethics, you get, but we're talking about deep-seated value clashes that don't go away. The Philippi horticultural area has not, the fight between the city council and the farmers has not gone away over 10 years, despite repeated attempts to address it. And so how ethics can help is it can start looking at what is the fight about? Why is it not going away? They've done scientific studies, the University of Cape Town's got involved, the University of Western Cape's got involved, they've done enough analysis of the aquifer, of the potential pollution points, of all the sort of analytical frameworks you can use. They have been done, but the problem hasn't gone away. That's usually an indication of deep-seated value differences. And sometimes it shows an absence of a shared set of common values, and sometimes it's because a new paradigm is emerging. And so why environmental ethics? Because it specifically looks at this relationship between human beings and the environment. So we're particularly looking at, in the Philippi horticultural area, who's making what claims about the environment? And where are they not agreeing? Where they're converging, where they're diverging? And this is very pertinent now because of this whole movement, this whole environmental crisis, climate change, environment's very much on the agenda. And what it's actually pinpointing from a philosophical point of view, and I'm sure you've heard of the concept of the Anthropocene, it's pinpointing that there's a crisis in the interaction between human beings and the environment, which is fairly obvious, but let's examine that. And why I'm particularly interested in this from a personal point of view is it's this whole almost crisis in Western philosophy. You know, in Western philosophy, we've started off with human beings as sort of conquering the natural world, trying to subdue it, to analyze it, to use scientific methodology on it, to understand the principles of it so that we can control it more. Now this has moved to a more ecocentric approach, which we're now trying to live with the environment. So we're trying to move from an anthropocentric to an ecocentric approach, living within the limitations of the environment. In African philosophy, that has never really existed. It's always been about being with, the idea of subject, object, environment out there doesn't exist in the language. And so this is an interesting, from a philosophical point of view, how useful can this be in relating to water governance? So it's quite far removed, but what I'm trying to say is there's an argument for a more indigenous approach to water governance. And possibly, yeah, we don't need to go through this from anthro to eco. We can look at development projects that focus on what's already there in terms of afrocentric ethics. Okay, so a bit more about our case study. And the reason why case study is always so useful from a philosophical point of view is because we're usually so pie in the sky. But this is a lovely case study to show you exactly what ethics can help with and what it can't. So the Philippi horticultural area is a small farm horticultural area in Cape Town with an underground water aquifer. The city of Cape Town wants to develop it for housing, industry and small farming. Now the agroecologists there paint the picture of the city of Cape Town as the bad developer. But it's not that clear cut because there is a real lack of housing. It is surrounded by shacks and gangs, and unemployment is high, crime is high. So these are agendas on the city council's list of priorities. They can't ignore them. Industry. They've started industries there, and it's been going for some time. So, and it's providing jobs. So it's not something they can ignore. Small farming, the agroecology that exists there is not And this is again another example of when you've got two different value systems working together. You'll find exaggerated claims. The agroecologists there would say we are producing 80% of the city of Cape Town's, with the food basket, we're producing 80% of the fruit and veg. Then when you hear other claims, it's less. It's 30%. So yeah, that's what happens. People exaggerate on both sides. So that it's undoubtedly provided fruit and veg for the city of Cape Town. And it has for many years. The history of that, I'm going to start coughing. Is there water on? The history of the area is actually started by German farmers many years ago. So it's got a rich horticultural tradition, and the German farmers have been here for some time. They left. Thank you. Due to economic conditions, that's almost impossible. But there's a tradition there of agroecology and working, because water is easily accessible. It's almost like a floodplain. It's got lots of accessible water. The city associations don't want any other development in the area. They just want it as a horticultural area for agroecology and heritage farming. So they're very much attaching themselves to the tradition there. Everybody is concerned about the pollution of the aquifer, especially given that we have hardly any water left in Cape Town. As I said, there's crime, unemployment, and the lack of housing in the area. So the city of Cape Town, they are pushing for the upgrading of the production of the small farmers. They want the small farmers to produce more. They're saying they're not producing enough. Not enough has been done in terms of farming. Whereas if you talk to the small farmers themselves, they're saying you're underestimating what we're doing. Everyone is calling for increased conservation to protect the aquifer. The city of Cape Town wants to increase low and medium income housing to address housing shortages in surrounding areas. So they want development, they want mixed income development. They want low income, middle income together, they want retail, and they've got development plans for that, and they have been passed at a certain level. But they've also been chucked out by the Heritage Council. So the Heritage Council, the Western Cape Heritage Council, is on the side of the agro ecologists. They're saying, no, let's preserve this area more like an agro-ecology village. But the City of Cape Town has a good argument in terms of industry, retail, creating jobs. They also say that the more development you bring in there, the better the roads will be, you'll reduce crime, you'll create market opportunities, and there'll be more connectivity. It's also, it's quite close, not too far from the airport, so access roads that way. The whole idea of sustained economic development. Yes, let's have mixed use. Let's have more agroecology, a bit improved agroecology, not more. Let's also have commercial and retail. So both sides sound pretty rosy if you listen to either one of them. The Philippi Horticultural Food and Farming Campaign, which is basically made up of a group of civic associations that have got together, they want a heritage site with minimal interference from outside. They want organic production and want to promote the better management of the area and water resources and local ownership of the land. They want to stop all future commercial and industrial activities, and they keep saying, when they say these paved areas, the developers want to go and pave and develop places, they're going to stop drainage to the aquifer. So what are the points of convergence in terms of what's been said and divergence? They're all saying they want to improve the area. They're all wanting more jobs, and they're all asking for better agricultural protection, and they all want to protect the aquifer. The points of divergence is how that looks. So the PHA campaign wants to have agroecology versus mixed land use. They want less outside interference, more local ownership and control. Whereas the City of Cape Town wants to maximize, open the area up to the rest of Cape Town. They want less municipal interference, they want more municipal governance. But I think essentially one of the core things is a rural sense of place, or a more rural sense of place, not entirely rural, versus a more urban, industrial sense of place. One wants to keep people out in a sense, so they probably would deny that, and others want to bring more people in. So, and the mudslinging that happens, or has been happening in the media for the past 10 years, is PHA farmers say, you just, the city council and the developers say, you're just trying to hold on to prime real estate, because it's right there in the City of Cape Town. The longer you hold on to it, the more the price gets pushed up, and eventually you guys are going to sell out anyway. You're just waiting for money to, you know, just waiting for the property price to increase. The PHA are apparently not serious about organic farming, they're more serious about property prices. And people are saying, the developers are saying, that farming is dwindling in the Philippine area. And it's not significantly contributing. There are other ways to contribute to the food basket in Cape Town. And then on the other side, they're saying the City of Cape Town, pro-developer, pro-big money, they're DA, run, the Democratic Alliance are run, they're in support of big money. That's what the ANC saying. The City of Cape Town is not interested in grassroots development, and they're not interested in managing the water resources carefully. I think in all of these, it's wild generalization. I think it would be accurate to say each of them are equally interested in development in the area, but it's what kind of development, and for whom, and who gets to retain ownership. So the question that we're asking is, so what is a good, ethics is about good, bad, right, wrong, praiseworthy, blameworthy, but what is a good development really? What does it mean? Which values should be prioritized? If you try and take an integrated water research management perspective, it's not going to take you very far, because you're still going to be stuck with the problem of whose equity, whose efficiency for whom? For the small farmers who claim to have more right there than the developers. So what we need to create in the situation to move forward in terms of better decision-making, environmental decision-making, is you need to create a common set of values. But before you get there, you need to develop a language. It's, in order just to get past that you're the bad guy, I'm the good guy, you're the bad, in order just to get past that, because we haven't got past it in 10 years, you've got to develop a common language that enables people to understand their own perspective more deeply and appreciate others. And this is not woolly, sort of huggy stuff. This is actually just basic things like, okay, so what's the most important, what am I as the farmer, agroecologist farmer, trying to preserve? Is it only my farm, or is it a way of life? Is it a rural sense of place? And what right do I have to that over and above a shack dweller who wants low-income housing? So it's about like developing almost like a discourse for what's at stake here. What do I really value? So for me, I think it's about that more rural sense of place versus a more industrial sense of place. And also from a philosophical point of view, it's about, is the water just a resource? So it doesn't matter if we use it for low-income housing or agroecology, or is it actually about water being connected to a way of life that I would like to preserve? And I don't think there is a resolution like that. But I think what could help and move past this mudslinging is better participation between the city council, the governance structure, and the locals on the ground. I don't think you need to do away with difference. I think that this tension is worldwide between more urban lifestyle and mixed land use to more sort of secluded rural. I think the idea is to keep them in tension with tangible indicators and to go with that, to move forward. So like if it's about how many hectares are paved and how many aren't, that's an indicator. So in order to move forward, everyone needs to feel that their values are understood and protected in some development plan. And then to jointly develop an indicator for that, that keeps the community connected. Okay, that's just one solution. I don't have the solution, but what I think will help is it's getting to the core issue. And the core issue is protecting my sense of place. And how can I measure that? And how can I protect that in a policy or in a policy in future decisions about the area? So that's how I see it as a way forward. But the aim is where this project is at is basically myself, DEEPA, and the Water Institute and the Unit for Environmental Ethics are looking at researching this and using this ethical methodology for water catchment areas. So this is like a pilot project to try and test will this actually make a difference? And we're sort of at an institutional level now looking for institutional funding to take it further. So I think that's what I wanted to do, and then now I'd like to invite you to mudsling, discuss value issues, disagree with me.
Questions? Well, I have. At least one. Isn't there a moral issue here? And I'm not an expert on ethics, but so more wealthy people might want more development and whatever, and housing. The housing company is going to be making profit from that. And even if they're building low cost housing, some of it might be low cost housing. Isn't there a moral issue about poverty here, and whether there are more vulnerable groups working in the horticultural sector who, from one side, on the PHA side, and more vulnerable groups on the other side who might need the low-cost housing? If both those groups get together and come up with a solution, wouldn't that be morally more appropriate than the wealthier sections of both sides?
Yes. So what you're talking about is the convergence there.
Well, there are subgroups. Within both these sides, there are subgroups.
Yes.
And there are more vulnerable subgroups. And is there more to give them a strong voice in this debate?
I think that's actually, and I think at the moment we don't get to that platform ever. So you're either in the promote low-cost housing development, or you're in the promote small farmer. So there is no discussion like that happening because of this impasse. So that's why we want to create a debate where those parties could actually hear each other and maybe connect.
And aren't we starting from the assumption that there needs to be a solution, i.e. you put up a good development, but surely there's a constituency who can say there's no need for any development at all. This entire conversation is morally bankrupt, and in fact it's completely irrelevant because we, a group, have occupied this land and are managing it and running it in a completely acceptable way as far as we are concerned. So actually the whole thing is irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm slightly struggling as to see where, you know, that shared language, I can entirely see where you're coming from in terms of the sort of stakeholder language.
Mm-hmm.
But if you've got no engagement to start with, then you're not going to actually get that language going at all, surely.
No,
I guess I'm struggling with.
No, we've got more than enough engagement. The issue is not. So this is. The big issue is between the municipality and the PHA campaign. So what's happening is that the municipality is trying to pass the development, and they have passed it.
Mm.
They've passed the development, it should happen, but the Cape Heritage Council has been called in, and they have to be taken into consideration because they are preserving the heritage of the Cape Peninsula. And they've been called in, and so the campaigners are using their argument to stop the development. So, I'm struggling to understand. There is constant engagement. It's just not taking the issue any further. And so, everyone wants to. The small farmers there are not producing. There aren't enough small farmers, and they're not
for all the area.
Yes,
right.
And there's a lot of dumping there.
So it's not productive, is it?
It's not productive enough.
Even in a micro.
Yes. So it needs to, a further development from an agroecology point of view, and it also needs the housing issue is major. So because it's surrounded by shacklands and gangs actually, so it's a very crime poverty area. I think what's very important what you're saying is we don't have that happening. We don't have the connection being made, because there are poor farmers and farmers also creating work. So the issue of what you want is a development vision that takes people with the same values forward. But we're not getting past that. We're not getting past this mudslinging.
And is that partly, you think, because we're now in an environment of essentially post-truth and alternative facts, and even if you produce an evidential base, actually one or other side simply will disregard it and say, those are your facts.
Exactly.
They're not my facts.
Yeah.
So I'm ignoring them.
No, I mean, if you read either side of the debate in the media, it sounds like both are perfectly valid arguments, and both are like morally good.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, somewhere in between all that goodness, we've got to move forward.
So what kind of methodology are you using? Because you haven't explained where you got this data from. Did you go and speak, interview people? And are you using this social learning kind of approach, which does get different groups together to try and come to a solution?
So we haven't. Our aim is to test the ethics methodology. Why? How can ethics help? How can applied philosophy help in the situation? Can it at all? So this is a case study we've identified, I've done a desktop analysis, that's all I've done. And now that we want to take this further. So we want to look at, can ethics help with water governance? And so what I've done is I've gone to the Water Research Commission in South Africa, and I've spoken to them about like how ethics can help. And they said to me, you know, actually, to be honest, we haven't even considered it. And our public participation processes are not working. And they said, that they see it as a big question mark, because they said we're good with science, we can fund scientific studies, but we don't know what to do with the people stuff. And so it is a gap. So I think we're timeless. It's a matter of just taking it further.
And it's been going 10 years, you say?
Over 10 years, the fight.
Over 10 years.
Yeah. It just doesn't go away.
But it sounds like it's the methodology which is the key thing. Having participatory methodology and having good facilitators to deal with those different groups. And it has been done in other countries and around water issues.
Yes.
And so.
But why? The question I'm asking is because of my interest and my research is why ethics? How can an ethics methodology, what does it add to the participation debate? Does it add anything?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it just pie in the sky?
Well, I think that's part of it, because you have to uncover people's different values and
yes,
as part of that process of negotiation. Mm.
It's almost like a negotiation. I'm suggesting, and my hypothesis is, it has it's a negotiation tool that requires people to examine themselves and to stake a claim. And then, but I want to go further as well. I want to say it's also about finding ways of monitoring that. So on a bigger level, we're talking about paradigm shifts, we're talking about values changing. And sometimes like our governance, what happens is like our governance structures in city councils are very much still stuck in the modern era in Africa, don't know about here, but still stuck in this idea that we want to create an industrial, but is it where we want to go? Do the agroecologists not have a sense of development, which is maybe more useful in the long run? So the methodology I'm suggesting is one that's quite concrete, not talking about philosophical values. I'm talking about tangible. How will I retain my sense of place of the Philippi area as a small farmer? What do I have to do? What can I negotiate to keep that sense of place? So it's kind of an effort, and that's my methodology that I wanted to pursue, is an effort to make values tangible. And how will I measure them?
And have you looked at methodologies in other places, like, for example, Australia, if you do Western Australia, where some sort of similar conflicts have previously arisen? Have you looked at how
they...
I just wondered whether...
Yeah.
Because I think they have applied some ethical analysis in those things, but I'm not aware of that, but I think that there has been some work there. So it might be interesting to look and see how they've approached that.
And other parts of Africa, and Wageningen University has done some work in the Netherlands around these kinds of issues. But the thing I was alluding to before, it's about the weighting. So if you're getting people's values and listening to everybody, but who's anyone's more important
than others?
So if you've got big business involved,
yes,
are you going to take their values just as equally importantly as...
Idealistically you would, but the reality is, does it happen like it? So power analysis, and that's where deeper would come in, is useful. But I think, for a start, I just want to get beyond the you're the good guy, I'm the good guy, you're the bad guy, and let's try and see if we can move past it. Yes, big money talks, and that's what the PHA farms are saying. You know, you the DA who's in charge of the city council is just trying to push big money. You just want the rates. You just want you're not actually concerned about small farms. I suspect that's part of it, but there's also another dimension which you pointed out earlier, that there's this low-income housing issue. And financing housing in South Africa is one of the most major issues. The government's not getting it right. So bringing developers in, forcing them to do middle-income and low-income housing is one way of addressing the housing issue.
What you set up is... you say the power analysis, a number of large players, but most importantly, an area where smallholder farmers, growers are doing their stuff, surrounded by low-income housing. So is there a way of breaking it down and looking at the relationships, I'm sure you're doing this, but looking at the relationships between those two groups who are the most clearly on the front line, using a framework in the Food Ethics Council, which I'm a member of. The Food Ethics Council in the UK. And it has an ethical framework, and it has three dimensions: well-being, autonomy, and justice. Right. And by applying that, certainly within the food system, it's sometimes quite helpful when you've got different competing interests around land or a supply chain or whatever it may be. I'm just wondering, to what extent you looking at that kind of approach between the in a sense, the key actors, as in terms of social relations, forget the money and capital and governance and politics, the key actors, to what extent can you use that ethical framework to sort of get that engagement between those different groups and to try and understand really at base where they're coming from? Because, I mean, as we all know, sprawling low-income housing across all green areas is not ultimately what people want. And equally, people defending a patch where they're just having a summer house is, again, not what people want in growing areas. So, what sense are you being able to approach that?
I haven't gone there yet, because this is at one case then. But I think what I'm really interested in what you said, and what both conversations have brought up, is this, what's unique about this is it's not rich farmers defending their turf, which is a very Cape Town thing. A Cape Town thing is the wealthy defending their turf in Cape Town.
Sure.
This is not that. It's poor farmers defending their turf. And I think part of the ethical analysis where it can help is exactly what you're talking about now. What's brought up in this conversation is bringing together the two parties that are actually making the same claims. It's about poverty, you know, alleviation. But now we've got two strategies for it. So that's the call. I think that's where ethical analysis can help. It's just this conversation we've had. It's moving it beyond you, the good guy, I'm the bad guy. Meanwhile, there's good and bad guys on both sides. So that's what it does. And then just taking that further, how do you translate that technique into a frame in decision making? So how do we protect that poverty alleviation strategy in the broader policy? Because you're still going to have competing claims. You're still going to have development. You're not going to do away with developers, but maybe the kind of development, should it be mixed income? Maybe it should be government subsidised in that area. So yeah, I don't know if I haven't done what you asked,
yeah.
But that's the kind of direction. Yes, I think it's very much applied ethics. So it's asking the question, what does good look like here? What is the good thing to do here? In terms of development for all, and in terms of the environment too. So that's where environmental ethics comes in. It's, is good resource management, just looking at the environment, the water as a resource, is that sustainable development? Or are we actually asked to rethink water? Water management is not just about clean water. It's about lifestyle and the kind of life we want to live here. Yeah. So in the end, what you're promoting is you're promoting, from this discussion, the low-income housing people to buy in to maybe the vision of agroecology. And how would you do that? And it also makes sense from what you said. I mean, it makes sense also in terms of the aquifer. You can't have one patch of the aquifer well managed and the rest sprawling township.
And there are lots of lovely examples, aren't there? I mean, I think in the UK alone, in London, we've created some 2,000 and odd new growing spaces. People have never grown stuff before in their lives. I mean, you've been very involved in that as well. And looking at the way in which city farms, for example, a bit of decline at the moment, but how they manage to negotiate with their neighbours their existence. And they do it by negotiation with the kids and the gangs and whoever it may be, and get them involved, and it's safe space in the end. I mean, these are all things that have been practiced in all across the world, and I'm sure that the same sort of things must be emerging.
Yeah, well, what's interesting is the townships have goats roaming in them and cattle. I mean, the classic picture of like driving to Cape Town, I love it, is this bridge that goes over the N2, and there's just like streams of packed cars, because they're always working on the N2, and then there's cars going over, and a herd boy is standing there. It's like, you've got like New York style traffic jam with cattle going over. So I think, and that's part of the what's happened in urbanisation, especially in Cape Town, is you've got a lot of rural lifestyles that have come into the city. And they're not urban, it's urban rural. And so the idea of like connecting those two groups is not difficult. It's not like the people don't know how to live like that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is what makes me excited, is bringing those ideas together. But at least just creating the space for them and not this kind of political... Unfortunately, things are so highly politicized in South Africa. Everything becomes a black-white issue or a poor... It becomes a poor... It's about poor and rich. And actually, there's a lot of other things going on. And an ethical analysis allows you to maneuver in those spaces. And that's what I'm actually just trying to create a space. Yeah.
This is my question. Like, doesn't university add some kind of chance to get part of this debate?
and try to create the space for the debate, like to, for these people to come together, sit at the table, and try to yeah to debate about their own values.
This is part of the paradigm of university, this whole scientific methodology and coming there, just take the samples and, you know, find out who's the bad guy, and, you know, it's not very sophisticated, so, and also very siloed. So it's like the University of Western Cape, they did a groundwater research. UCT did, they did a study of Battersby and Gareth, they did a study on property, it was more like a urban planning. Ethics is considered like, you know, really, it's not important.
Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, it is what's going to take you forward. Because everyone wants to be the good guy. Everyone wants to be on the side of the small, emerging. Yeah. So it's how you get past that.
Because, like, in other cases where this debate is already like, arose, like, many times, universities sometimes took like, people working in university, the part and they decide, like, they kind of act as facilitator, right? Like in a, like try to bring people at the same table. So that would be like a good way maybe for.
It would be a lovely vision,
yeah.
But unfortunately, universities don't often operate like that. They operate on the side sometimes of big business,
yeah.
Or like good science. So it's a whole lot. I mean, then you also critique, like, what is a university? Should a university not be community concerned,
yeah,
rather than academic excellence in terms of, yeah, ethics is not part of what they do.
Yeah, because it could be super virus, right? Like, it could
be creating spaces. I mean, that's what we should be doing. Yeah.
Excuse me, but don't you think that taking it on a scientific point of view will help bring people towards convergence, because it's facts. It's measured that if you do this, you pollute the groundwater, so you shouldn't do it, then you have convergence. Otherwise, when you talk about ethics, there are always people defending their views, and then to have a convergence will be more difficult.
Well, what facts? Is scientific fact so hard and fast? And that's another philosophical issue. So what happens here, we've got two sets of facts emerging. So one side says they provide 80% of the bread, they're the bread basket of Cape Town, they provide 80%. The other side says it's 30%, and they're not producing enough, says the city council. So whose facts? I mean, I haven't delved into whose facts are right.
This can be measured by crop efficiency, like, I don't know, selling on the market.
Yeah, but what indicators? It's like yesterday someone said to me, something about, is rural poverty worse than urban poverty? I said, it depends on your indicator. So for me, I work in an informal settlement. In informal settlement, poverty seems worse to me than rural poverty in South Africa. But it depends on what your indicator is. If it's access to schools, then it looks like the urban area is better. But access to what's happening in the schools, a quality thing. It's not that cut and dried. And everyone's facts are tainted in a way. And I'm not saying this happens with all scientific endeavor.
Yeah.
I'm saying it happens with things that don't go away. I'm saying when you need ethical analysis, this deep sort of, it's when things don't go away. When pure science, they call it a wicked problem in the literature. It's when pure science doesn't work. The more science you throw, the more people argue. So that's usually an indication that there's the value system's not, we're not all looking for the same things. Yeah.